Oh, good. The Water Utility Infrastructure Management Magazine. Been waiting for that.
It's my lunch, till lunch hour, Reba.
Well, you know, the good thing is I've become so much more informed about a whole lot of things, but I don't have anybody to talk to them about it. So I may have to call you 10:30 one night. Look, yeah, you know, I was really saying that. My wife told me to get lost and.
We're in some of my favorite stuff.
Right.
All right, everybody ready to go? Okay, looks like it's about 4 o'clock. We'll go ahead and get the June 8th, 2015 City Commission meeting underway with a roll call, please.
Mayor Blanchard.
Here.
Commissioner Crawford.
Here.
Commissioner Davis.
Here.
Commissioner Hardy.
Here.
Commissioner Ryan.
Here.
Would all who are able please stand and join the Pledge of Allegiance in a moment of silence.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, thank you. Looks like there are no awards and proclamations, so we'll go straight to the Citizens Forum. And the Citizens Forum is a time for anyone to come up and speak with anything on their mind that isn't on this week's agenda. And please just limit it to 5 minutes and give your name and address, please. And we have no takers, so it's a good week.
Yeah.
Oh, one. Got one. All right.
Patrick Harrington, 100 South College in Solana.
Can you pull the mic down?
Hello.
There you go.
Hello.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Yes, I do want to be heard. I want this to work. So.
There you go.
Hello. At home. To the citizens of Solana. And to the board. I bring something to you today. I've just met with Brad Nelson, Chief of Police, and spoke with him about it. And it's kind of a... It was an observation, but for me, it was spurred by a reaction to a poster that I saw, and I want to share that with you. So, that's the poster. Can I approach the?
Certainly. Yep.
Okay. And for the city of Solana. It's a recruiting poster for the city of Solana Police.
Recruiting poster for the police department.
Okay.
So, serving your country with honor, serving our community with pride, I'm behind those things, and the Pledge of Allegiance means something to me, and all of those things together is what's bringing me here to you today. So, a suggestion and an observation. What's wrong with this picture? It's not my picture. It's not the picture of my community. It's not the picture of some of my friends, many of my friends. It's not a picture of many of my children's friends. And it's a minor thing to some people that this the person on this, who happens to be a Solana officer, which is great, and he serves with pride, and he's an honorable man, and was a Marine as well. So it's not the dress. It's simply the person that is there, and it's the person of our community representing us without color. And I think that my observation with this is that these are recruiting tools, should be wider spread to look more like our community, and our police force should look more like our community. And Chief Nelson has said that he agrees with that and believes that it will get there, but at this time there's so much to work with, and he showed me some other brochures that don't look like this. So this, recognizing this is not the only tool that the Solana PD uses, it is certainly a very narrowly focused tool that was developed for recruitment at military fairs and such, but it's hanging in a public place that a lot of guys that aren't military don't see, members of the community were meant to see it, and this picture doesn't look like them. So my observation is that this is the time to change and make a new habit or a procedure, that things that go out to the public, especially when it's a public servant, that we want in our community to look like our community, to represent our community, that it have a little bit of a candor judgment on it first, like it goes to human relations or something, or the people that develop these have this in the back of their mind, that this, we're recruiting to a position in a city that is very diverse, and the picture of the best person we could find is the one we have lots of already, right? It's not my picture. It's not the picture of, most importantly, of my grandchildren's friends who are members of this community to be, to grow up, and they aspire to things that we want them to have success at, and they don't see themselves in this picture. I believe they will consider that this is not an opportunity for them. So this is not an attack on anybody's job or anything anybody's done or the way that we're policed, but it is an observation that to truly reach our full potential, we have to be an integrated, diverse society, and organizations that serve the public must look like that as well. And if we post this particular, not being the only one, but it's the one that I noticed and the one that made me uncomfortable enough to come here today with this message. So the whole thing is here. I took a copy of it. I've written my notes on the back. So I think I've said it all. I'd ask for questions or observations, or I don't know how the picture makes you feel, but it brings to mind places that I've worked that were very, very rigid and did not allow anybody who was not white to advance. And I've dealt with that, so I'm not, this is something that I know much about, and in the United States as well as other countries. So anyway, a question, a message?
Nope, I think we're good.
Yeah.
All right, well, thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay.
Anyone else? No one else. Okay, well, we'll move on to, we have nothing on public hearings and items scheduled for a certain time. We'll move to consent agenda, please.
Item 6.1, approve the minutes of June 1, 2015. Item 6.2, accept the offered sidewalk easement for Quail Meadows Estates Edition, Lot 11, Block 7. Item 6.3, resolution number 15-7246, authorizing the mayor to sign the agreement with Kansas Department of Transportation to exchange 2015 federal funds. And item 6.4, resolution number 15-7245, authorizing the mayor to execute a license agreement with USD 305, authorizing the placement and construction of a new loading and unloading space in the Fairdale Road right-of-way abutting Metal Arc Ridge Elementary School at 2200 Glen Avenue.
Okay. Just a quick question on this before we take action, and that is, on item 6.4, was that the item that was placed before us right before here? Okay. Can we maybe just get a quick explanation of what that is, and then I think we can probably.
Okay, actually, if you would, Mayor or Commissioner and Commissioners, I think it would actually be helpful if we could pull that from the consent agenda. There's some conversation. I think it's easily resolved, but something that you all would need to address specifically.
Okay, very well. Is there any other item that any commissioner would like to have removed?
I'll move that we pull item number 6.4 from the consent agenda.
Okay.
Second.
Okay, we'll just go ahead and do that. Are there any other items that? Okay, I'd be open for a motion.
Move that we approve the consent agenda as presented, minus item 6.4.
Second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second to approve the consent agenda minus item 6.4. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? That is approved 4-0, and we will hear from here. Item 6.4, is that Mr. Bankston?
Yes, I think it would be best to have that staff report presented as the blue sheet would anticipate, and then just a quick clarification that I can make afterward.
Okay, as Dean, Mr. Andrew.
Thank you, Mayor. Commissioners, as you're aware, the bond issue project is going on fast and furious this summer with all the various school sites around the community. And one of those school sites is Meadowlark Ridge Elementary School, where they're constructing an addition and remodeling some existing space there. And as part of that project and reconfiguration, they were proposing the construction of a bus drop-off lane along the west side of Fairdale Road, abutting the east side of the school. And staff reviewed that and identified it as being comparable to a private improvement in the public right-of-way that would best be authorized through a license agreement that would establish construction and maintenance responsibilities. That activity was not included in the building permit was issued and was brought to you for separate approval and authorization. The plans call for a 12-foot wide, 256 feet long lane along Fairdale Road. There would be a new curb and gutter section. Public sidewalk would be relocated. A portion of that relocation would be on school district property, so there would be an expectation that there would be a follow-up item where they would dedicate a pedestrian easement for that sidewalk outside the right-of-way. As we all do with license agreements, this was referred to all of our utility providers, and there were no conflicts identified and no objections. So it appeared that it did not conflict with any other use of the right-of-way, and so your alternatives would be to authorize the mayor to execute a license agreement with USD 305 or to postpone consideration if you feel you need additional information, or you could decline to approve the license agreement and provide the school district and staff with further direction. What you had in your packets that went out was a draft agreement that was prepared, and so due to the relatively short week, that was sent out as a draft containing the basic elements, and then what you have at your places there was a refined version of that agreement with all the modifications made by Mr. Bankston. So there's not the nuts and bolts of it are primarily the same, but there are differences between what you have at your places there and the draft that went out, and that would be an opportunity for Mr. Bankston to point some of those out. I'd stand for any questions you have about the design or location itself.
Any questions for Mr. Andrew on design or location? Okay, nope, thank you.
Thank you, Mayor and Commissioners. The modifications to which Dean referred were basically there under Section 2, Subpoint A, where we now address both the requirements related to construction as well as ongoing maintenance. And then our general indemnification language in Section 3, USD 305 is a school district, is limited in the extent of the indemnification they can make. And the addition simply refers to the lead-in language, to the extent allowed by KSA 78-8201A. That's the section that addresses the extent of the indemnification that they're allowed to make by state law. What prompted also this recent attention, I received a call not too long before the meeting from Aaron Wright, who is counsel for USD 305. And her point simply had to do with the fact that we generally refer to these, characterize them as non-exclusive licenses. And the district understands why, but was simply asking for the opportunity to be sure that if we were to entertain any other license agreement that would potentially affect that real estate, which seems rather unlikely, but in the event that that could possibly occur, they had asked simply to include in the agreement reference to the city agreeing to notify them and allow them to at least comment in that event. So we would propose to modify the section one by adding an additional sentence that would simply say, while the grant of the license is non-exclusive, the city covenants that it shall not grant another license agreement affecting the real estate to any other party without first providing licensee with written notice and the opportunity to comment. So the city would not be bound, or nor would there be an approval requirement, but just the opportunity to be aware and comment if that would ever be something that would come up in the future.
Okay.
I had emailed that shortly before the meeting to Mr. Andrew, and the question, I think, I don't know if staff had any other comment on that provision. We hadn't had really a chance to talk about it, but that was their request, and it...
Okay, was there, that is in addition to what we were handed up here.
Correct, that's...
Is there a substantial difference between this and what we got Thursday in our packet?
The references I made, well, go ahead.
What we did in terms of the draft that's in your packet is that we had developed some standard boilerplate language as relates to indemnification.
Okay.
And what Mr. Bankston did was go in there and customize that to the unique circumstances of USD 305. So that is the primary change between the draft and the what you have at your places there is dealing with liability and indemnification. But otherwise, the changes were not major. And what he just spoke to is in addition to the language that you have in front of you right now.
Okay.
And it makes reference to granting a non-exclusive easement there in the paragraph one, and the school district has requested that be clarified to give them a right of notice and opportunity to comment.
Mr. Bankston, not to put you on the spot, could you give me just an example of what might be another grant? License for that same area?
That would be difficult.
Okay.
I can't anticipate one. I don't know if anyone else can more readily, frankly.
There is a possibility that if you had someone who was not a franchise utility that might be in the business of laying fiber optic cable or things like that. The Salina Regional Health Center has fiber optic cable that they place in the right-of-way and in different parts of the community through license agreement. So it is theoretically possible that somebody might want to use the Fairdale right-of-way for installing fiber optic line, and that would require a license agreement. And so that's the one example I can think of.
Thank you.
Okay, any more questions for staff? Okay, is there any public comment on this? I see no public comment. I'll bring it back to the board for action.
Mr. Mayor, move approval of resolution number 15-7245, authorizing the mayor to execute a license agreement with USD 305, authorizing the placement and construction of a new loading and unloading space in the Fairdale Road right-of-way abutting Meadowlark Ridge Elementary School at 2200 Glen Avenue. With the addition to section one, as stated by the city attorney.
Have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second for the adoption of resolution number 15-7245, authorizing the mayor to execute a license agreement with USD number 305, authorizing the placement and construction of a new loading unloading space in the Fairdale Road right of way, abutting Meadowlark Ridge. Easy for me to say. Elementary school at 2200 Glen Avenue, with the additional language provided in section 1 for as provided by council. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? That passes 5-0. Thank you very much. And that'll move us to administration, please.
Item 7.1, second reading, ordinance number 15-10778, amending Chapter 30 of the Salina Code by establishing Article 3 pertaining to alarm systems designed to summon a police response within the city of Salina, Kansas.
Okay, ordinance number 15-10778 was passed on first reading on June 1st, 2015, and since that time, we have received no comments regarding this, or have we?
No, we have received some comments, and what they're related to is really one comment at this point, but I think there may be others, and it relates to the change in the service. Today, we have multiple parties who, when their alarm goes off, it goes directly to dispatch to a unit that we have that's been there for, I think, 15 or 20 years, where we do direct alarm monitoring, and part of the intent of this is to eliminate and no longer do the direct alarm monitoring there for the private sector to do that. However, one of the questions that was brought up last week had to do with engagement on that, and I did some double checking, and we found that we had not engaged those with the direct monitoring directly, so to speak. And so we really want an opportunity to do that because we believe there could be a couple pitfalls, particularly with governmental entities, maybe beyond that. We want to check and see what they are, and if we still don't want to use the old unit and replace that, but there may be other technological options if by chance we find that we have to do some of that. And so I've spoken both with Chief Mulliken and Chief Nelson, and in order to give us time to both solicit input to kind of synthesize it, see where we need to go, and possibly, if we need to, make some changes, we're requesting that this and the next item you have on your agenda both be postponed. I'm just looking out 4 weeks, but the 29th would be a problem, so it really puts us July 6th would be fine if that works for the commission. That should give us time to work through that. And if we need more time at that point, we'll ask for another postponement. The time frame we have here is really an artificial time frame set up by us. There's nothing that presses us, so we don't feel like, or we do feel like we can take the time to work out those questions. Other than that, we haven't received, to my knowledge, any input or concern, so it's just really digging into the engagement of that one piece and then making sure that we can accommodate that need one way or another.
Any questions for staff?
Just monitored, are banks monitored directly by the
I can't say department? For sure, but I would not be surprised that they are okay. Today. And I think in this case, we just want to be sure that we need to turn over those stones and make sure there aren't certain requirements. So, for example, what if there's a federal requirement for a bank that says it has to be a direct monitored situation, something that we're not aware of? I just want to be sure that, double check all of our paperwork, make sure we don't have any existing standing agreements on the monitoring piece. So I don't think it'll take us too much time to get to the questions and get the feedback, and then we'll should be able to figure out where we need to go from there.
Since the first reading, I've gone through the new policy more thoroughly, and I do have some specific questions. I don't know if that now would be the best time to address those so that they can be answered between now and the time that we review the.
Yeah, we're comfortable with that. That way we can, during that time, we can also follow up on any questions you might have.
Okay. Well, I have actually six questions. The first one is on page 5 of the new policy. It's item C towards the top of the page. It says an alarm registration shall expire 1 year from the date of issuance and must be renewed annually by the alarm user by submitting an updated registration application and a registration renewal fee to the alarm administrator. I'm assuming that this is applies to commercial and residential installations. This is going to be quite a new kind of requirement for at least residential installations, and I didn't know if this kind of thing is requested, it may be difficult to enforce it, is all I'm saying. I mean, the resident has no way to have the alarm system approved or whatever the company has to do without calling the people to come out and take a look at the alarm system. And so it'll be quite a process. And I don't know that residential alarms anyway change much from year to year in terms of their ability to respond to alarms and that sort of thing. And unless it's possible for the companies, the alarm providers, to do that kind of testing every year of a residential alarm to make sure that it's working properly. The other part of it is if there's some, you know, $100 fee or something like that to register the system every year, to me that would be one of these things where you buy an alarm, then all of a sudden you're going to have all these other things that are required in addition to or just for the privilege of having the alarm, you're automatically subject to a lot of additional things that didn't go into the original decision-making process. So that's one thing that I had questions about.
Commissioner, I want to be clear that we understand the concern, because as you know, the registration is intended to be sure that we have information about each alarm. That's the primary reason. And we'll bring those fees back and expect those to be a very reasonable fee, so I wouldn't expect.
But this is an annual process.
It's an annual process. The question I have is that is the concern, it goes back to if there's a malfunction, if there's something or possibly something that's the responsibility of the alarm company that could keep the alarm from being registered, that then we have that triangle of relationships between the city, the alarm company, and let's say a resident possibly. And for example, if a resident has a 2-year contract for the alarm system with that company, but the company has an issue technically meeting the ordinance, and as a result, we're saying we can't register, but you're still stuck paying for a 2-year deal, regardless of whether they're able to do their job or not. Is that the biggest piece of the concern?
Well, that's another part of the concerns.
Okay.
But
well,
I was going to get to that one.
Well, I'm kind of hearing maybe. I don't know if this is what you're hearing, but what I'm hearing you, perhaps part of the concern, is that this kind of, on the surface, appeared to be presented as a false alarm ordinance and not a alarm registration ordinance.
Yeah, the purpose of the registration is to be able to respond with regard to the false alarm piece. So I don't know that you could implement a false alarm ordinance without the registration piece. Now, the registration piece can be very simple. It can be very inexpensive, and we can be sure. I mean, if we do our job right, we can be sure that every opportunity is given to make sure that people aren't unsuccessful by chance. If someone just simply doesn't want to respond to it, that's their choice. But outside of that, we intend to be very helpful, because we need to know where all the alarms are. And we need to be able to have that. So that's really what that's intended to
do.
Well,
I think a safeguard on that, too, and my only concern would be is, since we do have this third-party alarm administrator, that those fees don't somehow get set outside of a range that we might all be comfortable with.
Yeah, remember, there's a couple sets of fees. What we're talking about here is simply the registration fee. I need to speak with both chiefs, but I don't believe that crosses over with the alarm monitoring company at all. The alarm monitoring company, I believe, their issue will be with fees associated with the multiple false alarms. And the intent of the fees associated with the false alarms to create a means, well, it's an incentive or disincentive, if you want to say it that way, for someone to address their false alarms and no longer have them, because each time we have a false alarm, we're sending a crew, fire or EMS crew or police crew, out of what they need to do in a way from helping folks that have a real issue. And so you have to create a disincentive, and the fee at certain point is intended to be a disincentive. And so that's where the alarm monitoring company and the fee relationship comes in.
So is that, because what Commissioner Hardy just read, part of that section was the registration renewal fee was to be paid to the alarm administrator. And my understanding was is that the police department was not going to be dealing with any of the admin. They were going to have a third-party administrator and wouldn't be dealing with that type of administrative work directly.
The under definitions, the alarm administrator means the person or persons designated by the chief of police to administer the provisions of this article. So in that particular case, that doesn't necessarily mean the alarm monitoring company. As a matter of fact, I don't believe that's the intent. I need to check that, but I don't believe that's the intent.
Well, we've got time between now and whatever.
Yeah, that's not really what we're using the monitoring company for. That's on the false alarm piece. So I believe the alarm administrator, what this means is the chief's internal designee is going to be the person that's the alarm administrator. I'm quite sure of that.
Well, all right, Greg, we can get clarification on all your questions.
Yeah, but I want to be sure I understand the concern.
May I interject a thought here? Excuse me. There is a difference between the security systems and the fire systems as well. The fire systems, 99% of those are monitored by an outside third-party administrator and not by the city of Salina themselves. And there is a requirement for those inspections to be taken place on an annual basis, whether it be from the city fire department or from the third-party administrator. So there is a difference between the fire and the security systems as far as false alarms or alarm systems and monitoring.
Yes, and speaking, that's commercially based, I believe.
Right.
Yeah,
that's correct.
Not residentially. Many times the residential is a combined, different type of unit, completely different type of unit, but combined. But yeah, the alarm administrator is an internal approach. That's our department, not an outside person.
Well, there's another thing, and I don't know if this is a requirement for residential. I'm assuming it is. On page 7, item G under section 30-60, says all alarm systems shall be installed and supplied with an uninterrupted power supply. And that, once again, is something that may or may not exist in residential installations, and something that would, although it may be an item that's good to have, would present an added burden to residents that might have to comply with that.
Okay, we'll go ahead and take note of that and get an answer for that.
Yeah, we'll check and see.
That might just be a battery backup.
And then
on
page 9, under 30-63, false alarm fees, item E talks about you get to waive the first false alarm during each one calendar registration period upon the alarm user's successful completion of an online alarm user awareness class. And this is something else that might become something that's difficult to enforce as well. I don't know.
I think inherently it's you don't have to do it, but you don't get the waiver.
Well, yeah.
It's an incentive, I think, more than anything.
That's true. But my question was, then you have another false alarm after you've completed the course. Does that mean you go through the course again?
And who conducts a course, you know?
It's online.
I
it's
think there
online.
Are several questions.
On page 10, item A, it talks about there's a list of things where the administrator may suspend an alarm registration upon 30 days written notice. And it gives a list of items. And some of these items may refer to the alarm company instead of the residential customer. And does that mean that the police may not respond to some alarms if some of those items have not been met?
I'll be clear with you. It does mean that at that stage, there would not be a response to the alarm. Now, if a person picks up the phone and calls, there's a response. But to an automatic alarm, the answer is yes.
Okay. And one last thing on the same page, under section 30-66, there's a whole section, suspension of response to dispatch request of certain monitoring companies. And this one, means that if a company fails to comply with one of our requests or parts of the policy, then that company can be suspended from being part of our response system. And that takes on a whole series of complications with residential customers. For instance, if the residential customer has a 4 or 5 year contract with the alarm company, and then the alarm company all of a sudden doesn't comply with something that we're requiring, that does that mean that the residential customer is then on the hook for 4 or 5 or 6 years worth of fees to that alarm company, even though that alarm company is not going to be part of our system, part of the system that connects to the police department?
I believe at that time, and maybe you can comment on this, but I don't know if there's, it seems to me that would be a contractual
it's
deal
only
between the customer and the
Alarm company.
And the alarm company.
That is, but if the alarm company is not considered compliant with the policy by the police department, then the alarms issued by the residential customer from that company will not be responded to.
Yeah.
And that is not the expectation of the residential customer if they do have an alarm.
Well, and I think that perhaps, you know, through our process of giving notice and giving opportunity to comment and to respond to these things, I think we're more likely to, rather than try to figure out all the different scenarios that might provide them issues, if they come to us with questions and comments, I think it's probably the best way that we can address those. I mean, I think there are going to be some conflicts from time to time, and this is hopefully the process that we use. And I think, correct me if I'm wrong, wouldn't this be the case on any ordinance that we ever pass on anything? Is that?
Yeah, I think when you, well, and I guess I want to, before I answer that, I want to make sure, Commissioner, these concerns, they appear to be related to the residential customer. Okay, I think
the commercial customers, I think, are more in tune with these kinds of reporting requirements or filing registration papers and all this other kind of stuff.
Yeah, and you know, given that we started with a template, I can tell you that these main provisions are pretty core to you being able, as a governing body, to allow us to enforce an ordinance to keep us from having more false alarms than we need to have. You're still going to have some false alarms. However, it gets into the approach, the due process, in essence, of if from the point of, hey, you have a false alarm, to, in essence, a suspension of service. And so what we'll do is we'll go back and look at these and sort of go back through and play them out again and see what they mean, see how easy or more difficult it is to get to those, see if we can possibly tweak that. But I think you're going to have those types of provisions in place. I don't know if they're fully intended to be, well, according to the language, it looks like they are fully intended to integrate or incorporate the residential customer. I don't know if that was intended or it's just was drawn up without a thought of separating because they are different systems. But even so, residential false alarms happen as well. The commercial, I believe, are the highest volume, but the residential false alarms do happen as well. And we the thing we want to focus on is not the cost issue so much as the cost to do that, but is it's being out of position, whether it's a emergency situation, a police situation, or fire, when we need to have those crews somewhere else. So we'll look at each of these and come back.
Just to follow up to what Commissioner Hardy was saying, would there be a provision for the consumer protection that if an alarm monitoring company was suspended, there's some way for its constituents to be notified that their monitoring company is no longer active?
Yeah, we can do that. They basically
revocation
at that point in time. So I think we could probably put that burden. We have to check. I think we could probably put that burden. The biggest real question here is in that triangle of folks is that kind of goes back to that scenario of the alarm company doesn't do its job and you bought that service and you bought that alarm and it's not working properly. Now, we'd like to think that everybody reads the fine print and understands it when you have somebody come to your house and you sign a document, but we know the reality is that's not the case. So most people, if I said, what's the detail of your alarm contract, they're going to have to read their alarm contract because they couldn't tell me. And I, you know, same thing from my perspective. So probably the biggest issue is the impact of a suspended company to someone who's under contract with that company and what that means. And we may be fairly limited in what we can do about that. But we can ask that question, too, because we know many others who have ordinances very similar to this, and I think that'll help us chase down the answer to these questions.
I would hope that alarm companies are not surprised by this kind of policy from operating in other cities.
They shouldn't be, since it's a template policy that's pretty generally applied. And I'm sure all of them are probably tweaked a little bit, but I wouldn't expect it. If they say they're surprised, I'm not sure I'd believe them.
I guess I thought when this was presented to us that it was just commercial. And so thank you for doing that, Commissioner, because I really just thought it was for commercial.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
and I think it was presented that way.
I don't believe it's presented that way, mm-hmm. Commissioner. The full intention
fire
is okay. Residential and commercial. Now, I think what you saw, though, the volume, I believe, especially on the police alarms, is primarily commercial. And there was a lot of discussion about that as we were talking
maybe
about getting crews on the wrong locations and so forth. That's primarily commercial.
Mr. Mayor, I move.
One second. We'll just make sure nobody from the public wants to comment on that thing. Mm-hmm. But seeing that, any public comment? No? Okay. There you go.
Thank you. Mr. Mayor, move. I guess postponement would be the proper verb.
Correct.
For July 6th, I believe, is the date you suggested.
To Monday, July 6th.
Consideration of item 7.1 and 7.2.
Yeah, well, go ahead. Would you like them to go ahead and do just this item, Greg, and then when we bring up 7.2, just take the same action?
That would be best.
Since we have them separated on the agenda.
All right, 7.1.
Second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second to postpone until Monday, July 6th, 2015. Agenda item 7.1, and for the record, ordinance number 15-10778, and that is a postponement of the second reading. Motion and a second, and is there any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? That passes 5-0. Item 7.2.
And Mr. Mayor, move postponement of the second reading of ordinance number 15-10779 until July 6, 2015.
Second.
Okay. Just for formalities, no public comment on that either? Okay. Okay, so a motion and a second to postpone second reading of ordinance number 15-10779 until Monday, July 6, 2015. Any further comment? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? That passes also.
Mayor, just a quick add-on to that is, of course, that delays implementation a month. We have the ability at second reading to move that effective date out if you should choose at the time.
Okay. Oh, great. Thank you. Item 7.3.
Item 7.3, authorize the purchase of a replacement playground structure for Steve Hawley Park.
Okay, great. Mr. Louthan for a staff report on this one. And great job on that Bicentennial Center study session and field trip.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Mayor and Commissioners. Item before you today is in regard to the Steve Hawley Playground. Give you a little bit of background. We went through a process, specifically Mr. Ash, our park superintendent, to go through each playground that we have and basically look at it, rate it, score it, so we could get a prioritization of what pieces of equipment or what playground specifically we wanted to prioritize as we move through the capital planning process. Actually, Steve Hawley, the one we're talking about, is number two on the list if you go just by the numbers. But it is one that we are prioritizing for a host of reasons. From all our reviews and different things like that. What we did from there in the process is we looked at the age of the equipment, the condition of the equipment, the safety from the ASTM standards, if you will, and again, not to get too in-depth there, and then accessibility. And from those features, that's how he came up with a score for each of those. Now, there's some subjectivity to it, but this gives us a decent planning tool with which we can look at and try to make informed decisions as we move forward. We went through an RFQ process. We had seven firms, if you will, respond. From those seven firms, we moved three on to the interview process. We interviewed three of those firms. From that, we felt like AFCO had the best presentation, had the best packet. Due diligence was really good. We've had great experience with them in the past. Their references checked out very well, and we went into a design with them. We met with them on several occasions. We also met with Mr. Hawley. We looked at a playground that has several different features where he is prominent with the Hubble telescope. So we have a spaceship type design. We're utilizing some of his images that he took as part of, or that Hubble has taken as part of it that he picked out. We have interpretive features built in where it's got some proximity. So if you're at a certain location in the park, there's other ones that will spatially give you awareness as to how far X planet would be or Y planet, so on and so forth. So trying to make it fun, informative, educational, etc. Long story short, or fast forward, we originally had slated this for the 2014 budget year. We were chasing a couple grants to try to offset the funding. We did not get both grants, but we did get one. So what was originally a $55,000 project had gotten up to $93,000, so it was more than we had originally wanted. We identified some funds that we had available in the Special Parks CIP. We were able to move those over from some savings in some other areas and some funds that we didn't use. We got a $10,542 grant from the Access Foundation of Kansas to knock off of that. We also went after the Kansas Department of Health and Environment Waste Tire Program grant. We did not get that one. I made a run at it. End of the day, we do have the funding available there if you so choose to authorize it for us to purchase the equipment and put it in. We are looking at a community build day, which also helps save us money, so we will build that as a community in a single day. Part of the process is bringing out a certified installer. We would have a few park staff on hand and then bring the community in. Mr. Hawley's indicated a willingness to come down and help with that as well. So if you were to approve it, the funds are there. That's the process that we would use, and I would stand for questions.
Okay, any questions for staff?
I've heard from some neighbors in that area who approached me. They saw this on the agenda for today, and they're excited that the playground's going to be rebuilt.
Good. One thing to note, too, is part of that process that we did is it had a bigger footprint before, so we actually shrank the footprint that we believe is a more appropriate size for the playground and the usage that it gets, and tried to make it a little bit more economical in just the way the space was utilized. So they will still get the same type of equipment, just in a smaller footprint, if you will. And a lot of times the cost is in the surfacing. That is where there's a great deal of the cost, and the surfacing is obviously important in any playground. So,
forgot the question the neighbor asked me to ask you. Is there lighting? Will there be lighting in this park for evening?
No lighting is planned as part of this.
This is a daytime park only.
The amenities as they exist today from a lighting standpoint would stay the same.
Okay.
And looking at this from the overall picture, I mean, this is going to be a great addition to this park. Is the accessibility, are all the sidewalks adjacent to this park in good working level, safe condition, are we aware of the condition of those sidewalks?
We recently completed, and I'll call up our concrete expert, Mr. Ash, but he basically just went through the whole system. We did the same thing where we did all of the sidewalks, all the linear, and come on up, Bob, but all of the sidewalks and all of the fencing where we did an assessment of that. And we have started same process with the high priority areas, started taking funding that we got this year to repair and take the dollars as far as they would go. But I'll let him talk a little bit about his linear footage and what he's found. To answer your question, I don't know for sure how or what it is exactly in that park.
Okay.
Didn't think I'd have to do this today. We actually have 10.9 miles of sidewalks in the park system. I did go through, I walked every one of them, kind of looked at the joints, looked at ADA issues, cracked, and so forth. We had some funding this year. We repaired all the ADA issues in Oakdale Park, and we repaired them all in Jerry Ivy Park. So we have funding left to go through some of those other parks. Also got a firm that's going to survey Sunset Park and come up with a new method. We might try grinding some of those joints down with a special grinder they have. So to answer your questions, yes, we're looking at all the sidewalk systems and trying to, hopefully my goal things this year is getting most of, if not all the, all the AD issues taken care of in the park system.
Okay. Well, it just because my concern would be that if we are going to put an investment that large into that play equipment, that, you know, we're looking at the sidewalks. Do you say there's fencing at that park, and maybe even
there's
benches and other things that if we're bringing this from an, if this overall park is an F, and
right,
we just fix the park equipment, we're only bringing it to a C. But if we bring up everything else, we bring it up to an F.
Part of the assessment, if you look under ADA accessibility, it's on the accessible route, the accessible surface, and the accessible equipment. So the route is included as part of that assessment.
Oh, okay, great.
But to answer your question, exactly what condition the entire thing is, I couldn't do, but that is part of the scoring process for that, because having an accessible route is part of that as well.
Okay, because I do know we have a sidewalk fund, and it just seems that if we don't have the funds, we don't have the money in the fund for the park, maybe we have it for, you know, part of our connectivity.
Sure, yeah, it does make sense that if we're going to make that big of an investment in the park, if there's some other aspects that are truly deteriorated, to try to take care of those at the same time.
Right.
So if we can make sure.
Certainly.
We do that.
Okay, super.
Okay. I do have a question.
Okay.
I noticed under usage, there's a low, medium, and high use designated there. I was curious, in any of the playgrounds, do you consider whether or not that playground equipment is the best use for that park, as opposed to like putting in sand volleyball or skateboard or some other use?
We have talked about that internally, but to answer your question, some of the low usage is due to the condition of the equipment, the type of equipment. Specifically speaking, we have talked about our approach with other parks and how we would do the playgrounds differently to best meet the needs of the neighborhood. For instance, there may be some where we have excessive playground equipment. We may have two playgrounds, and one correctly designed playground would be a better option than two, if that answers your question. So we have looked at that at different places, and Bob and I have had some conversations about that, how to prioritize it, move it to discuss and see if there's benefit to do it. But we haven't advanced that far because we've just kind of hit the first few here with regard to the highest priority. So we have a few more we'll probably want to bring in the future.
Okay. Tell us again, a rough date for installation on this would be?
Late summer, early fall.
Okay.
It's lead time, probably 12 weeks on the equipment, 8 to 12 weeks.
And how are we going to work with our community relations department? I mean, it sounds like a perfect opportunity to do.
Yeah, absolutely. There are national programs that try to get your community to come together. I like the thought that we're doing this on our own. Absolutely, we want to try to get to folks as many ways we can to say, come be a part of putting this park together.
Right.
And again, generally speaking on those, and we certainly want to invite all comers and have as many people participate, but there is a right size to do it and do that effectively too. And for a playground of this size, that 20 to 30 number is probably about right. You hate to get 100 there and not have work for 100, if that makes sense.
And I think probably if you, I know USD 305 and Ambucks did the fully accessible playground at Coronado School a couple of years ago, and that was a really successful build out there. So,
right.
And Mike is a member of Ambucks, as am I, but I'm sure they'd be more than willing to help with any information on, I mean, with the Red Cross and everybody else put together for that. But it's a great idea, and I applaud you guys for thinking outside of the box and kind of taking it down there. Route and the equipment sounds pretty exciting. So,
okay. Great, thank you.
Okay, I think we're good. And do we have any public comment on this item? Okay, I see no comment. Oh, Judy's going to comment.
Judy Larson, 715 North 9th. I just need to raise my hand and say I haven't gotten any response at all. about my question regarding accessibility in Hawthorne Park at all, and I would appreciate a response. Thank you.
Thank you.
I can provide an update, Commissioners. That first of all, that would be a pretty quick response when we're in the middle of or some of our summer things. But from a Pure ADA perspective, that's an accessible route. It's not the most direct route, which is the problem, because we don't have the most direct route in place. So one of the questions, though, is do we need to construct a sidewalk, or should the bus stop be moved, and which may affect the length of the sidewalk? And that's the question that we have out there. So I've asked our engineering division to speak with OCCK to take a look at that stop to see if there's a possibility of moving the stop. We might find that it's better to leave it where it is, but we'd like to ask the question before we just start building sidewalks.
Okay. So that's that engineer. Okay, thanks. Okay, bring it back for action.
Mr. Mayor, move authorization of the purchase of a replacement playground structure for Steve Hawley Park. And I guess my question, the exact figure is $93,723. That includes the grant, the $10,000?
It comes
out of that. All right, so we would actually be paying in the neighborhood of $83,000. Okay.
Yeah, the authorization does need to be for the full amount. We'll consider the grant just a revenue source.
Okay, thank you. I think that's it.
Okay.
Shortly.
Second.
Thank you, sir. I have a motion and a second to authorize the purchase of a replacement playground structure for Steve Hawley Park in the amount of $93,723. And is there any further discussion? I see none. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? That passes 5-0. Step 4.
Item 7.4, resolution number 15-7247, approving an economic development grant offer and agreement from Kansas Erosion Products, LLC.
Okay, Mr. Gage, please.
Thank you, Mayor and Commissioners. Attached to your report, we have a request from Mr. Steve Oddy, and Mr. Oddy is the owner and operator of Kansas Erosion Products, LLC. It's a new startup company in town. Mr. Oddy's a local person and is real excited about starting this company. And he is requesting $25,000 from the special sales tax fund, our economic development pot, to assist with the startup of Kansas Erosion Products. What they do is they make wattles, and they also make erosion control blankets. So typical, the wattles are the tubes filled with organic material that you might see at various construction sites, also the blankets. And it's the idea is to have the manufacturing of those close to the source of the organic material that you construct those with or create those with. And so this is a new opportunity. They want to get started here this month. It consists of a total annual payroll of approximately $357,000 with 13 new jobs in total. Of those jobs, there are approximately three of those jobs that would in essence equate to meet either the what we call the quality or premier level, probably one premier and a couple of quality wage level jobs. The emphasis really here is on the having an opportunity for a startup, a small startup company. The use of the funds would be to take special German manufactured type company that's specific to this operation and have it disassembled in California, moved to Salina, reassembled, and then properly calibrated and so forth so that it runs properly. And the operation, of course, then to start. And so again, the request is $25,000. This did go through the your Economic Development Incentives Council, which is your advisory committee that deals with economic development requests. They did vote unanimously to recommend to you approval of this request. A couple other pieces. The applicant is leasing a Salina Airport Authority building, which is, it's always good when we hear that some of those buildings are getting leased up. That's a good positive thing for our community. We do have approximately $606,000 in the what we call the SEDIC sales tax pot. That pot generates the revenue is about the revenue source generates about $330,000 a year, just to give you an idea of the cash flow of that. So this is a fairly small grant and or incentive grant, and as I mentioned in the report, you'll typically see when you talk about the, just if you just relate to the quality slash premier jobs, you'll see that ratio is a little bit different than what you might see for a larger company. And again, the opportunity here really, and from the SEDIC's perspective, is to work with a local owner on a startup small business and be able to help that startup small business and hopefully have a business here that has growth potential in the future. So with that, I'd be happy to answer any questions. And Mr. Audi could not be here this afternoon, but Tim Rogers, Solana Airport Authority Executive Director, is here, and I think he can answer more specific questions about the applicant and the work better than I.
Okay. And then I will just add that I am your representative on the SEDIC, so if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer too. So with that, if you have questions for me, Mr. Gage, or Mr. Rogers at this time.
I'll just throw mine out. One thing I couldn't quite figure out, is the company already in production? And if so, where?
They are not in production, and I think Tim might be better suited to, well, the company at this location, they have a relationship with a company in Georgia, but this company we're talking about in Kansas is not in production, and that's, again, that's part of getting the equipment here so they can be in production. And the draft agreement you have stipulates that the equipment has to be brought here, reassembled, and production needs to be started in order to qualify for the grant funds.
Okay, so the contracts that he has then are brand new contracts for a brand new company that's not operating yet. And so these will be totally brand new jobs?
Yes.
Then. All right.
Totally brand new jobs in Salina, okay. Yes.
Okay. And do you, Mr. Rogers, did.
We'll go ahead and have Mr. Rogers come up.
Come on up. This is an ongoing business, I'm assuming. He has 12 contracts now, but this is something he would anticipate will just be growing as time goes on?
Yes.
Yeah.
Commissioner, if I could probably expand on the overview that Mr. Gage has presented in response to your question. This is a startup, true startup business in our community by Mr. Audi and other business partners that are starting up, making a capital investment, making a commitment to the community to bring this new business venture here. The steps that occur in the development of a new business have been multiple, and one kind of lays on top of another to get to this point and this final action. The business is truly a startup, and that the business was Kansas Erosion Products was incorporated as a corporation within the state of Kansas just this year. Business plans have been developed, and the idea, of course, developed out of an existing business venture that Mr. Audi has, and that he does purchase wheat straw, and he distributes that already throughout the United States. And he's purchasing not only within Kansas, but up through the Great Plains, up to the Dakotas, finding another source, another use of wheat straw that benefits wheat producers in the area as another sale, another market, and that is the erosion prevention and control wattles and erosion blankets. So truly startup, and investors and other business, other consultants have been involved, and they've settled on a process that is based upon equipment that is made by a firm out of in Germany. The equipment that would be relocated to Salina, Kansas is in Bakersfield, California, that would come to Salina. And the grant assistance is directed towards helping with that relocation of that equipment. One of the steps that was involved was to secure the location for the manufacturing facility, and the company will be leasing 34,863 square feet of building 1021, located off of Airport Road on the southwest side of the Airport Industrial Center from the Airport Authority. The long-term commitment that has been made by the business is 75.5 months. So it's a long-term lease. It is not intended to be an annual activity. They are committed to for that period of time. And I'll stop there and see if I've gotten close to the background and the questions that the commission may have.
That helps. So that's a the company is ready to go, except for the fact it doesn't have the machine that it needs to make its product.
This is the last piece of the puzzle. Okay. The lease has not been signed at this time. The Airport Authority approved the terms of the lease agreement, and the SEDIC action was a step, and now final action by this commission to approve or disapprove the request for the grant funds. Then the company will take action to make final action on their part to execute the lease agreement, but it's pending until this decision is made. It's a but-for in the process of how they proceed ahead. The grant funds enable them to move quicker than if they did not have the $25,000 from the sales tax fund for economic development.
Was there a plan B? If
there is a plan B, and that means they cannot move as quick, they can't take on as much production. They do have sales orders pending, may not be able to hire their employees as quickly. It's 13 initially, and they have a business plan that forecasts up to 30 to 35 employees, so their growth is limited because they'll have to use more resources to finish the relocation and installation of the equipment being moved from California.
Thank you.
How long has that space been vacant? Was that the one that you said the National Guard had?
It was space that was occupied by the Kansas National Guard for 8 years, and the Kansas National Guard, due to the loss of funding from the National Guard Bureau, they had to vacate the building in January 2014. Okay. So it is reusing a portion of the building. And of course, we're optimistic that Kansas Erosion Products will grow sufficiently and quick enough that they will be able to lease the south portion of the building and expand right at that location.
Right. Well, it's good to get that back into productive use.
It is.
Quickly. So
very much
good.
So. Mm-hmm.
Is this considered an unusual amount of money? I was just thinking in terms of $25,000. Like you said, it's probably not a make or break amount of money. And to me, it sounded like the kind of money that you would offer out to potential startups. Say we have this pot of $25,000. Bring us your ideas, and we'll help fund them for you. And this particular request to me sounded like, well, is it really necessary? Now, with your remark, it does indicate to me that not necessary, but it does speed up the process. And so for that that reason, I think it would be a good investment to get this business up and running. So I guess the other thing I was thinking of was this: would there be unintended consequences, which in this case could be good? I guess maybe we should be looking for more opportunities to fund startup businesses, set up some sort of pipeline so that we could take these dollars that are available and use them, not necessarily looking for the next Phillips Lighting, but looking for half a dozen people that are anxious to get moving, but they just don't have sufficient funding.
The community does have an existing program that is to do that, but not to this level or this level of funding. City Commission has approved, and you have an operation Project Open, mm-hmm. which provides for both commercial, retail, and manufacturing industrial type of projects. And so there is a means there. The maximum grant for Project Open for and just a pure grant is $5,000. So mm-hmm. there's a limit there. And Mr. Gage may want to clarify this if I misstate it, but I think the process that we have now on a project like this, whether it's existing business or new industry, new business looking to start up, still has access to these to the SEDIC process either way. And what we're looking for is go down and narrow down and get to the kind of the last remaining, you know, amount that's truly needed to get the project over the top and get the project you know, launched. So with even the SEDIC process, there is that ability to, again, work with the, you know, both existing and then new startups such as Kansas Erosion Products. And Hopefully I stated that correctly there.
Just one general question. Does the SDIC ever loan money to startups as opposed to granting money?
No, Commissioner, the SDIC's role is strictly advisory. And we don't have, with the city of Salina, we do not have a revolving loan type fund program set up at this time. So we're not in a position to actually loan in that way. Now, it doesn't mean that you couldn't structure a grant in the loan form if we felt the need was there. That's always a possibility, but we haven't gone there, so we wouldn't have a template for that at this time.
North Central Regional Planning Commission, an arm of their operation, does have a revolving loan fund that they do partner with us on.
Yeah.
On many occasions and providing that.
And depending on what your business type is and what your needs are, as Mr. Rogers mentioned, the Project Open at the Chamber is a program that can link you to certain loan programs as well.
And just to follow up on the comment, North Central Kansas Planning Commission was a partner in this project and was involved in finding other options. When you get to the point where time is of the essence and that some of the process programs there were not applicable, but will be there for maybe future growth for the company after the company is established. The Kansas Department of Commerce was involved, the Salina Area Chamber of Commerce, City of Salina staff, very helpful in defining issues as far as, you know, the use of the facility. And right now is a, you know, potentially a multi-tenant facility, and how do we bring the company in with a portion of the building vacant. And Fire Marshal Williams, very helpful in assessing the equipment and comparing that to the fire suppression equipment and system that's in the building, so that we found that this current system will meet the needs. So many parties involved in the process to get the project to this point where they're ready to start business in our community.
Just one last question. This money is to help get the equipment here. I'm assuming the company has a plan for operating expenses to keep it going until it starts getting paid for the contracts it has.
Yes, the company has local bank financing that's in place. One of the steps that they went through is going through local bank financing. Again, the personal commitment by the parties involved. So there's substantial amount of personal finances involved in the project, and the grant dollars involved become are not the primary means to launch the company. So then the risk has been assessed at each step of the way. And the Airport Authority's lease, looking at that, the Airport Authority Board is looking at the creditworthiness as we are preparing to enter into a long-term lease with the company.
I'm sure you two would probably have asked a lot more tougher questions than I did, so I'm comfortable.
No. These are good questions. Very helpful.
All right. Any more questions of Mr. Gage or Mr. Rogers? Nope. Tell you what, I'll just take a brief moment to summarize maybe just the SEDIC board action, just to kind of let you guys know from that standpoint. It is a seven-person board, and all seven members were there, so it was everybody was really interested in being a part of that, because we haven't had a whole lot of requests brought before us. So I think everybody was anxious to hear the proposal and take action on it. So I can tell you that I think it was a consensus of the board that Mr. Oddie was a known person in the community and business person, and he laid out for us different items of his business plan, a significant part being that he has substantial contracts already in hand from a company that he was delivering his product to in Georgia, which now they'll be able to manufacture it here where a large source of that material already exists. So it was a great partnership between himself and a manufacturer that already had a number of orders that they needed to have filled. So you know, he's got 13 employees that are ready to go now, and it really sounded as if that 13, he was going to be stretched pretty quickly. So I think the growth potential for his business is pretty strong, and what impressed me the most was really that in our community, we've had a pretty
good track record and sort of a DNA of economic gardening and homegrown business successes. If you look at Vortex or Great Plains or Crestwood or some of these other that started out as really small companies and were able to grow, and if you, I think if you could go back in the Wayback Machine and see what they were doing when they started, I think it'd look an awful lot like this. So it's $25,000. It's a quick thing that they need. He's already got everything planned out. I think it's a good thing that we're able to utilize the airport properties out there in a productive way. But the biggest thing for me is I think it really, if we're looking for things to check off of our to-do list, I think this is a perfect example of local economic gardening. And I think, Commissioner Hardy, you hit it really well, and it was, I could have been saying the same thing, because I agree that we have a lot better opportunity for success to spend $25,000 at a time for a 13 or an 8 or a 6 person startup, and with known quantities and known people and people in the community with ties, than trying to spend $500,000 to go try and land a 50 job manufacturer that's from out of town somewhere and trying to do it hunting versus gardening. So I think the consensus of our board was that it was a really great opportunity to help partner with a member of the community that has a great idea and a great entrepreneurial spirit. And I think before long, he'll probably double that and triple that workforce, and I think that's a good thing. So that was pretty much, I think, the consensus of that SEDIC board. So.
Thank you.
And do we have any public comment at this time? And I see none. We'll bring it back to the board for action.
Mr. Mayor, I move we approve resolution number 15-7247, approving an economic development grant offer and agreement from Kansas Erosion Products, LLC.
Second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second to approve resolution number 15-7247, approving an economic development grant offer and agreement from Kansas Erosion Products, LLC. Any further discussion? And I see none. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Approved. Opposed? Okay, that's approved, 5-0. Thank you.
Item 7.5, consideration of a request for a permit to keep bees within the city of Salina.
Okay. This I got to look at this one. Staff, Mr. Gage.
Thank you, Mayor. This is the buzz around town, I believe.
Yeah.
We have a request from Father Kevin Weber. It's attached to your packet. He is the new pastor of St. Mary Church here in Salina, and will be moving from Salina from Hayes to Salina very, very soon to take over his duties here. The parish offices are located at 230 East Cloud Street, and he's requesting the ability to keep a beehive at that location. There are no neighbors with real close proximity to the location. And, we presume already that he has permission from the church to do that. That's a foregone conclusion and something he'll have to deal with if not. But he's indicated he's kept bees as a hobby, and it's a hobby, it's not a business, for 4 years in Hayes. Never had an incident there with anyone, and actually indicated that any interest has been positive interest versus a negative interest. Our code, we do address it in our code, section 7-34 of the Salina Code, and it indicates that it's unlawful to keep or harbor bees within the city limits without first obtaining a permit from you, the city commission. So, of course, staff put this together for you. The ordinance provides for an investigation report from the county health officer. That portion of the code sort of reverts back to the combined health department, but we still feel it's applicable, and we made a request, and Dr. David Dupe with the Saline County Health Department was very gracious as health officer to respond to our request. We're very appreciative of that. And his recommendation is attached as well, and it's fairly short. He basically indicated he's read the application. The applicant appears to be an experienced beekeeper. He's reviewed the photos of the area and doesn't see any neighbors close by, which might have been a concern to the proximity of where the bees would be kept, and as a result, he doesn't see any public health concerns that are known or immediately known to him. And happy to answer any questions if we have further questions. So he feels comfortable with the request. This is a little out of the ordinary for us. It's the first one that I recall actually seeing. It doesn't have a fiscal impact, but we provided a couple alternatives, obviously to approve or not to approve the request. I think the biggest thing about this is that you do have the full discretion under the code to revoke the permit at any time for any reason. So if there is any problem, a complaint or anything, we can follow up. But if there's a need, we can revoke that pretty quickly. So from a staff perspective, we really don't see a lot of harm in it from that angle. Be happy to try to answer any questions if we can. The applicant was not able to be here this afternoon, so we'll try to do our best. But just quite honestly, this is a topic that's not part of our expertise. I like to think we do have topics that are part of our expertise. This isn't one of them. So I don't know how helpful we'll be on technical questions, and that's why I sort of take you back to the ability to revoke that if it doesn't work out.
Were there any unintended, or potential unintended consequences that were explored?
Well, that were explored, I'm not sure.
I mean, like spreading of his bees to the next available house. I mean, it's only thing I know about bees is
hive jumping.
That I run away from them. So
we do know that they like to be in colonies and they like to stay pretty close to their hives. So I think that just that knowledge of bees is pretty helpful. And it appears from the note that was taken into consideration as well somewhat by Dr. Dupuy. So we don't believe there's an issue from a geographic perspective or worried about bees in essence running away. They do like to stay close. It's one of those queen bee worker bee deals. So we're not too concerned about that. Probably the biggest concern there could be is if someone's messing around and makes the bees angry, and somebody can get stung if you do that. But it appears there hasn't been an issue in Hayes. So again, we're not concerned about that, and quite honestly, if you purposely try to anger bees, you have a little of that on you.
And this wasn't being done as part of a gardening, of a garden project, or?
No, not to our knowledge, no.
No further questions? Any public comment on this item? All right!
Greg Weems, 118 South Second. I'm a beekeeper.
All right, super.
So I kind of fit the bill for some of your crazy questions. But I tried a year and a half ago to get with the health department on getting a kind of a streamlined version of a permit system, because a lot of the big cities are going to a permit system for keeping bees in there. It's becoming more popular now, and it used to be real common in pretty much every city in Kansas. Everybody had. City of Salina does have the statutes to it. It is almost impossible to get a straight answer out of anybody as to how to get it to go through. And I was working with the health department prior to their little structural integrity issue. And we were making good progress and trying to streamline it in a way that the public could get a hold of it and kind of run with it, make it more accessible so that if your 65-year-old retiree wanted to keep bees in the backyard, what are the requirements to do? What do I have to set up? And there are no real specific requirements in the city of Salina for what you can and can't do with bees. There needs to be. A lot of your major cities, New York is allowing bees. New York's not really a city you would think of having bees, but it's real popular there. San Diego's another US city that allows bees now. And it's all based on a permit system. They have a fee, a permit, and an inspection, and that's just pretty much the long and the short of it. There are certain criteria you have to have, can't be certain feet from the public accessibility. If it's within a certain distance of where the public has access, there has to be at least a 6 to 7 foot flyaway partition in there so that bees are going above people's heads, not at people, things of that nature. And I'm not commenting pro or for on the pasture. I'm just giving you a little background information on kind of what the general scenario is for beekeeping in bigger cities.
Well, I'll tell you, Mr. Gage, maybe you can help us out on this. I'm reading section 7-3.4. It looks like we got a pretty streamlined system. I mean, we don't have anything on flyways here. And
it's streamlined. It just doesn't really probably address aspects. Maybe it should. I totally agree. This is a pretty old piece of the code. when you look at a community of our size and an organization of our size, to take a B permit to the commission seems to be sort of a trivial type action to take to you. I'd be happy to work with Mr. Weems and see what we could do to create a streamlined approach, which also has some common.
So you're talking more administrative.
Structure. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Because this seemed like it was a pretty quick.
Most of the big cities, they have a permit. You go to the health department, or you go to city of San Diego. I believe it's more the animal control officers. You go through that system, you have to file a permit, you have to get an inspection, and you know, it's just bada bing, bada boom, bam. You're either approved or you're not. There's a fee involved that goes to pay towards the city, which then contributes towards the inspections, the funds, and basically just part of the city. You want to do this, you need to be responsible for it. You know, we don't want this person who can't afford it just throwing together a hive that the first windstorm comes along, blows it over, then you have a swarm of bees all over the neighborhood. Type deal. And what he said about the swarm issue is, you know, there is that liability that as a beekeeper, you have to keep your bees out of your neighbor's house. And that is the responsibility of a beekeeper.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and he's obviously an experienced beekeeper. The pastor is. He knows this stuff because he's kept it. I've done things in public with bees around people. I've never had issues with people. They're very respectful bees. And honestly, the dumbbells that run around the public, they straighten up very quickly when in the area or location of something that can sting them and cause pain.
Mm-hmm.
It's amazing how that changes the attitude. So, but it's just, my comment is more, what can we do to get this more available to people? Because I've had a lot of people ask me over the 7 years I've been doing this, what can I do to get bees in my backyard? What is allowed? How can I do that? How can I do that in the city of Salina? And there's a lot of master gardeners out there in the city of Salina that want bees. Hmm. You know, I go over to the master gardener area and I put up bait hives for the city parks. And there are so many people who comment on how they like seeing the bees on the flowers. There's so many articles in the newspapers across the country that say, hey, the bees are disappearing. You need to do your part. Well, how can you do your part if you can't do your part? So.
Okay, well, I think it's, now that we do have the animal control services, mm-hmm. maybe that's the most logical place. For
yeah, that, you know, this is, like I said, this is the first permit request we've had, so we weren't aware of that. It wasn't passed up to us, but yeah, I agree, and I think that type of process would work great. We have the animal control function is now City of Salina function.
Well, so I think they're manned a little bit more.
Yeah, if you wanted to provide information to my office, and I can kick it over to them, and we can start talking about it.
Thank you.
Be happy to.
Yeah, thanks for sticking around and
thank you.
Asking those questions. That's helpful.
I guess the wind blowing a hive over is one of those unforeseen circumstances. Yeah. I was asking about. Okay,
is there any more public comment? Seeing that, I have to thank all of you for avoiding all the different bee puns that you probably could have gone after. City manager notwithstanding, but.
To be or not to be, Mayor? That's the question.
All right, I spoke too soon.
You did.
Okay.
Well, I have an unintended beehive. I put out grape jelly for Baltimore Orioles.
Yeah.
And all I'm getting are bees.
Yeah. Well, birds are bees.
I'm keeping my birds away, so.
Yeah.
So we need more beehives.
Exactly. Do I have a motion on this particular item then?
I move we approve the request for permit to keep bees within the city of Salina.
Second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second to approve the request for a permit to keep bees within the city of Salina. Any further discussion?
I was just going to say, I bet Father Weber, when he gets here, would be happy to help with that, too, if you have any questions.
Super.
I would assume he would. I don't know.
Yeah. And we welcome him on July 1st to the city. Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? That passes 5-0. Okay, we have no development business. Do we have other business?
I'm going to bring up the fireworks again.
Okay.
We've had a week to think about fireworks and what works and what doesn't. And my thought is that last year I was paying pretty close attention to the fireworks in town and noted that there was a lot of enthusiasm about fireworks and the use of fireworks on the 4th of July. My concern is that the enthusiasm sometimes needs to be corralled a little bit. The curfew was not widely observed, and also the part of our policy that requires that all of the residue from the fireworks remain in the yard where the fireworks are discharged is not being observed as well. And so I think those two things need to be addressed and communicated to the city possibly before this next round of fireworks on the 4th. And one thing I was going to suggest was that we need to have better or stricter enforcement of the curfew. And we could do it in one of two ways. We could have more officers designated for fireworks curfew enforcement, so that and the other part of it would be to eliminate the warnings for violations of the curfew. Just go straight to the ticketing for it. The other thing that we could do, I was thinking, is that rather than try to address individual parties, if there was you can hear and see where the fireworks are being discharged all over town, go to Indian Rock Park and have X number of violations, and then you some enforcement goes into place for the entire city. And so those are two ways that you could address that. And I don't know what you would do about the residue part of the policy, if there's something we can do, or what we can do for that part of it. But anyway, those are my comments.
I would think, as far as the residue, I probably would be too late to do anything this year. But if it's possible, restrict the height to which the rockets can climb. I'm more worried personally about a fire being set remotely.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, most of them do burn out before they hit the ground, but the ones you read about in the paper are the ones that didn't. Or even grass fires, they didn't have to be a house fire.
Let me quickly summarize. I got three things here, really. I've got a residue issue, and which pertains mostly to maybe modifying language in the ordinance. The curfew enforcement and a no warning thing. And then maybe a fourth one is, which is, maybe you can help me with that, public warning or
citizen engagement.
Or, I mean, you know what I'm saying? It's like everybody needs to follow the rule, or else.
Well,
or else.
Well, and I
because
think
that's that a tough. That might be. I mean, would that say it? So there's four.
Yeah, when the the commission that established the ordinance that allowed fireworks did not know how this whole thing was going to come out, how it was going to play out. And I think now that we've had this ordinance in place for a while, it's time to consider whether or not that ordinance was the one that works well for our city, so that people can have fun with fireworks, but also people are not there are no unintended consequences there, where people are dealing with junk in their yards that they didn't want, or if their roofs are endangered or whatever.
Okay, thanks. Well, you had your, let's just go this way, and then we can kind of maybe give direction to.
Well, I agree with Commissioner Hardy. I just think the size, maybe the size of the fireworks or the height, because it's awfully loud. I mean, it sounds like a war. I just really think we need to have, like you said, a public admonishment or something.
Just need a reminder, you know, the drink and drive people also, there's a responsibility aspect in this, and maybe people just need to have it, be reminded of it. It's the day the 2 days we celebrate our independence, so I would not want to take away anybody's fireworks, but they could behave better with it. I don't know how you can limit the size of the firecracker. That doesn't go to, I don't know how in the world you could enforce a thing like that.
I think the approach.
But the littering part of it and enforcing the hours we have, those are useful things.
So as far as the suggestion that the curfew be strictly enforced, meaning no warnings.
Mm-hmm.
How do you guys feel about
I'm
that?
Fine.
That's fine.
I mean, people should know the hours and conform to them.
Okay.
And then just
particularly the days before and after.
And then just to back up a second with the size and the height and size of these fireworks. Hasn't it been the policy that we would, and we did it with the Chinese lanterns, that we would restrict those that show up on a certain list of dangerous?
Yeah, what we do is we use the list that the state approves, state of Kansas. For example, it prohibits bottle rockets. Bottle rockets are not legal in Kansas. They're legal in Missouri, at least they used to be when I was a kid. But the lanterns are not really a firework. They come out at this time of year. They're truly a floating fire, which is why they're so dangerous. Quite honestly, this year, the three things I think we can do, it's no question, we can get the word out early. We're going to be strict on enforcement. Don't make us bring this back. The idea of losing the privilege at some point in the future, if it doesn't get calmed down, keep your trash off of your neighbor, if you can. I mean, quite honestly, it's difficult, but we can enforce that. We can cite for that, strict enforcement means we may not issue warnings. I won't totally take that away from law enforcement because they need to have discretion because everything's situational. But generally speaking, we'll be looking at pretty strict enforcement, I would think. And quite honestly, we've done it enough years. I don't think that would be any surprise. We would get that word out anyway, but I don't think anyone would be surprised by that. Fireworks is a type of thing. The leniency allowed will dictate the practice. And so we need to, I think we can rein that back in some. And we're only talking just a handful of days because we don't allow it for like 2 and 3 weeks. And so I think we can rein that in and see how it goes this year. I don't think that's really a problem at all. I think we can do that, and then see where we're at the end of this season.
Should we allow for additional officers to be available?
You don't need to allow for it. I can just, if you want strict enforcement, I'm going to have more officers. I'll just authorize them to have. I mean, we're going to be paying a little bit of overtime, but that's, again, it's not like you're able to shoot them over 3 weeks, and it's just a handful of days. It's not too big a deal. It's not going to break the bank to assert the enforcement level if we'd like to do that. It's no big deal. We can do that.
I think we had a complaint last year, as I recall, that it was one of the intersections in town. There were people out in the middle of the intersection throwing firecrackers.
Yeah, that's blatantly
around,
illegal. If we see that, I would expect a citation. The problem you typically have is when you're especially concentrated right around that 4th, you do have it going on in many places, and that's why I think we need to hit it. And I think the idea that you may not get a warning anymore, or just get your fireworks taken away. You might get them taken away, and you're going to be cited. And if you want to take that chance, take that chance, but it's going to cost you as much as it did in buying those fireworks, maybe more. I think that'll help, and then make good on it.
You know, I appreciate whatever he's wanting to get at, but I agree that there needs to be some sort of area for discretion for the officer because, I mean, if we want to take into consideration that it's going to be late at night on the holiday weekend and probably some people's are going to be a little impaired by other factors and perhaps sometimes if there's the ability to diffuse a situation, then I think they probably need to be able to have that sort of ability to do that.
It's an issue of some things happen accidentally when you're doing things,
right,
you know, like that. But really, it's a balance of officers' time getting around the community. You know, if you get to the point of citing somebody, and I need to check. I don't know if that's a charge that can where we can use our mobile handhelds. I don't think so, but I don't know that. if we can, actually, we can be a lot more efficient with that than we could before doing it the paper way. But usually it's a matter of how many officers and the contacts the officers make with the public. And if you can warn and you think you've gone, you passed that situation, it's not going to happen again, you can get to the next one, you're balancing the impact that you might have. But I do think that we need to be clear about a strict enforcement and emphasize that and have strict enforcement. We give them some discretion, but generally speaking, have pretty strict enforcement. If you'd like to see if we can rein that in some, yeah, I think we'll need to do that.
And I think that would help everybody enjoy the fireworks more.
So, could part of the enforcement be that we evaluate the success of this plan that we're proposing sometime after the 4th?
Sure. Yeah, we typically collect information on injuries that are reported by the hospital and the clinics like StatCare. We track the complaints, whether it be trash complaints, which you usually, surprisingly, don't get that many, the noise complaints, things like that. So, and then the rest of it's pretty anecdotal. At that point, when we say it sounded like a war zone or something, I don't know how to compare that, but hopefully you'll be able to say, or people will tell us, no, it was better than the year before. And so we'll have a little something there.
Okay. While we're here, are there any board reports that anybody had in their different board appointments that they feel might be helpful to share?
I enjoyed going to the Airport Authority board meeting. Since my husband was in the Air Force for a good many years and retired in the Air Force, I told him out there that day it was like going home. And I've always appreciated so much the Airport Authority. You know, as we traveled through the years at different Air Force bases, it was always kind of like the base was always kind of like just a beautiful place within the city, because it's always green, kind of an oasis, especially in Southwest Texas, I remember. Everything was pretty arid, but the base was always just beautiful. And when I go out here, I think the same. Everything is well trimmed, beautifully taken care of. And, you know, I don't know how they do that, because that's all different businesses, but it's just very nice out there. And I would say anyone should just take a drive out there and look around. We always took people out to that area just to look around, and I appreciated that, as well as all the business that went on at the meeting.
Great.
The North Central Regional Planning Commission, a lot of times works behind the scenes and does things for communities that are not necessarily newspaper worthy, but that organization of which I'm part of includes 12 counties. And the organization provides, among other things, weatherization help for people who might need it for their homes. Just recently, several of us were part of the Bulk Solids Innovation Center in the north part of town, and the Planning Commission was part of that project as well. So there are things that go on in the community that benefit by the participation of the North Central Regional Planning Commission that may not realize it. But it's a great organization. I'm really happy to be part of it.
Great.
I feel almost guilty having as much fun as I do at mine. Arts, humanities, travel, and tourism. I mean, it doesn't get any sweeter than that. But it's a good barometer of how the rest of the state sees the line. I'd say we're looking pretty good right now.
It's great.
Some real hard-working folks.
I agree.
Housing Authority approved their 1-year and 5-year plans. Cool. I'm totally lost in everything they do, but I'm beginning to study it a little bit when they start talking about vouchers and transporting people between communities. It's very complex to me. So.
Well, I think you probably catch on pretty quick to that stuff. They do a lot of good work over there, too. And I think with our housing needs assessment, we'll probably start to all get a little more familiar with that, so appreciate you being on that committee. My other committees are Chamber of Commerce and the Library Board, and of course the library across the way has a lot of summer programs for kids, and one of the unique things that they have coming up is the schools have adopted the Chromebooks, giving Chromebooks to kids. And one of the things I thought was kind of a neat thing was a partnership between the library and the school where they're going to teach incoming freshmen how to use the Chromebooks so that when they get into their freshman year that they already know a little bit about the Chromebook so that they can hit the ground running and learning with all the other things that go along with being a freshman in a new high school and everything else. I think that would probably be very helpful there. And then, of course, the bulk solids research facility is all open now, and that's been the latest thing with the chamber. And just one other thing, economic development related. I stopped on a quick stop between here and the Bicentennial Center to see what was going on at Save a Lot. And they're not going to be open on the 10th, but it looks like probably within 2 weeks they'll be ready to go. They've got a lot done in there, and things are looking good. So I think we're probably right around the corner on that. And so that's everybody's report. Thank you, everybody, for those. And I just want to make one comment before we go, and that is I know all of you are aware of all the stuff happening with the state legislature right now, and in particular as part of the wrangling to get a tax bill figured out here, they've been making some proposed amendments and passing different things. I don't know where, Jason, do you know where they are on this? Have they voted? And
The Senate passed some form of a bill that included the tax lid that you're going to get to, I think.
Right.
I believe they did. And so I don't know if the House has acted yet, because quite honestly, this thing started off about a week ago when some were gone, some were there. Everybody's waiting for a budget. I don't know if they're idle during that time or not, because you can't engage everybody at the same time. There were meetings, discussions over the weekend. The Senate had taken an action to bring that in as a separate matter on a tax lid for cities. And I say tax lid, it's cities can't raise property taxes more than the impact of the consumer price index, however they, in their fine language, would define that. And then the Senate turned around and said, no, we're not going to do that, by about the same margin that they said they were. And everybody thought that was gone. And then over the weekend, they decided to bring it back, put it in some form of a tax bill, and include that. And it was my understanding that did pass, I think, last night. And I think the biggest concern is, and spoke with the media earlier, and I said it's not a surprise that a state government is focusing on the topic of local government tax limitations. Although I said, with the caveat that all the city governments in the state have their own electorate that are perfectly happy to, you know, tell you to take a hike if you don't do what they want you to do. Be nice to have some respect of that. But the issue, really, to me, is not the topic matter as much as it is when they talk about limiting to the consumer price index and the sales tax proposals that have been coming out are, you know, 0.4%, 0.5%. You're well above the consumer price index with those and other, some of the sin taxes, other taxes that have been thrown out there. And yet, with this situation, the state legislature here in the bottom of the ninth inning, for a little baseball analogy, has not taken any of those bills or considerations through the typical committee process. They have not provided for any citizen input, nor do the citizens get to vote on the sales tax proposal. In Salina and all the other cities, if there's a sales tax increase, there is a vote. There is not statewide. There wasn't the last time when it was 1% and it came down only 0.15 instead of roughly almost half as it was supposed to. Now we're back going up again to offset the reduction in the income taxes. And so there's a big tax shift going on without any public input requested whatsoever. And the movement is so fast, happening on a weekend late at night, that we can't even get the language to read and to formalize any opinion on before they take action. And so if there's one way to create an environment not to get input, is to do it on a weekend late at night and not have the language out there for people to read and see and comment on. And that's really where we're at right now.
Right. Well, thank you for that summary, and I think you've all have gotten some of the reports that we get from the Kansas League of Municipalities, and we appreciate our membership with them and what they're
very
able
much.
To do for us. But I provided each of you with a letter that I wrote to Senator Arpke, Representative Clays, Dirks, and Johnson on this issue. And I'll just summarize with the last part, and I think to follow up there, and it was just that I just wanted to let them know that I think all of us, we believe that our local elected officials are best suited to identify community needs and address the challenges we face and govern the most effectively. And as elected representatives of local citizens and being full-time residents ourselves, we are directly accessible and accountable to the people and are in the best position to be the most receptive to their concerns. And I know that all of us are out in the community all the time. People tell us what's on their mind, what they feel about kind of what we're doing. I do think that, and this is one in a long list of things that the state legislature has felt like they have to treat us like that they know better and that they can identify and take care of the needs of the citizens of Salina better than we can. And I think hopefully they'll get a backbone and stand up to the governor and some of the ridiculous tax policies that they've implemented and reverse those and let us all go on about our business and represent the people we're elected to represent. So anyway, that's my little rant. And
I'll vote for that.
That was my letter. I added the part on the last part. It was a very respectful letter.
And it was. It was good.
But anyway, good. I want to thank you guys for all. I know serving with all of you that you are responsive to the citizens of Salina, and I know staff is, and I know I hear positive comments in the community all the time, so I know citizens appreciate it too. So anyway, that's all we have today, so we will entertain a motion to adjourn.
Adjourn.
Second.
Second.
Motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.